window for them to gain more knowledge from over the places. And this is why languages is a very key element for their development. Well, Thailand has placed great importance on inclusive and equitable education as well as lifelong learning. Therefore, many national legislative instruments related to education focus on the provision of education to people of all ages and all walks of life. Currently, the government of Thailand has made great strides during the Millennium Development Goal era, achieving nearly 100% primary school enrollment for many years. We have provided 15 years of free education, starting from kindergarten until high school. This free education also covers 230,000 children who are undocumented, stateless, as well as children of migrant workers. On the other hand, UNESCO 2017-2018 Global Education Monitoring Report indicates that only 55% of students complete lower secondary education. For the way forward, the government has just designed and introduced a digital system to trace children who are at risk to drop out and miss their education opportunities. We expect to use this system to locate this group of children and find appropriate solution for each child to ensure accessibility to education for all. We have categorized that around 14% of school age students are disadvantaged, while 25% are poor. Those who are categorized as very poor will be granted to top up allowance as an education subsidy to ensure they will remain in school. Teachers also play an important role in quality education. Therefore, in this year, 2019, Education Equitable Fund will provide homegrown teacher scholarship for poor secondary school students who want to become teacher in school in disadvantaged community. Most significantly, in small schools, teachers sometimes have difficulties communicating with their students. This language barrier is an important issue we'll be discussing in this conference. And for Thailand, we are tackling this issue by developing several model programs in this area. In the south, we have the Patani Malay Thai Multilingual Educational Program, which won both the 2016 UNESCO King Sejong Literacy Prize and 2017 Wen Sui Award for innovations in the professional development of teachers. This project was an excellent example of cooperation between the Minister of Education of Thailand, Research Fund, UNICEF, Mahidol University, Yala Rajapat, and local communities teachers, parents, and students. The students in this program learned to read and write in their local Malay language. And then they transition to Thai using a special curriculum that developed Thai listening skill before moving on to speaking, reading, and writing. A similar program in the north, organized by local education authorities working hand in hand with the Foundation for Applied Linguistics and the Pestalozzi Children Foundation, has helped children from seven language groups. The research findings from these two projects are now helping the Ministry of Education and several children develop better methods of teaching Thai to the 400,000 migrant children who live here. It's important these children learn Thai so that they can benefit from the education that the Thai government offers them. Indeed, education can help guard these vulnerable children from human trafficking, drug abuse, and many other social problems. Thailand is proud of those projects in the south and the north, western border areas, which will be featured in three panel discussions during the conference. I believe expanding this and other innovative programs will help Thailand achieve its SDG 4 goals. We also hope that Thailand's experience and expertise can be helpful to other countries. In closing, the MOE would like to thank for all of your commitment to children, all children regardless of race, religion, and language are precious to their family, community, and country. Let's work together for the brighter future for them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Your Excellency. Delivering the opening address, Dr. Kraiserm Tohtubtiang, Secretary to Minister of Education, Thailand. Your Excellency, may I please request you to remain on stage for the group photo session. And now may I call upon Mr. Shigeru Aoyagi, UNESCO Bangkok Director, and Mr. Andrew Glass, OBE, British Council Country Director, to present on stage for the group photo session. Thank you. So remain on stage, and now may I call upon Francisco Benavides, Regional Advisor of UNICEF, to be on stage. Secondly, Philip Party H, the Secretary to the All Party Parliament Group on Modern Languages, UK Parliament. Thirdly, Jan Nolander, CARE Cambodia. Next, Bridget Burgard, PCF Southeast Asia Program Director. And next, Michelle Ken Mockney, Executive Director, SIR International. These are the partners, and last but not the least, Emeritus Professor Dr. Suvilai Prem Sirat from Research Institute for Languages and Cultures of Asia, Mahidol University.
Thank you very much, Excellencies, distinguished guests, for the great group photo. Next, we'll start with the keynote session for the conference. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ms. Alison Barrett from the British Council, the moderator of the keynote session.
Ministers, friends, colleagues, gives me great pleasure to be here welcoming you this morning. This is my third language and development conference, so I'm really pleased to be here working on behalf of the Language and Development Trustees, and really happy to be working in partnership with the Asia Pacific Multilingual Education Working Group. There are few speakers, I think, here in this room today who can address the conference's themes of inclusion, mobility and multilingual education better than Professor François Grin, who's here with us today. It gives me great pleasure to introduce him to you. First of all, he's truly multilingual. He speaks around five languages, as I'm sure many of you do as well, French, English, German, Spanish, Italian, and he reads many, many more. His love of languages, he tells me, started back early in the early days of his career with an interest in Celtic languages, and he was in Ireland studying Irish for a time. And I think this love of languages has propelled him through his entire career. Professor Grin is a full professor of economics at the University of Geneva, and many of you will know him for his work in language economics, the study of the ways that linguistic and economic processes intersect and connect. He's published widely on this topic, both in English and in French, and I'm sure many of you are familiar with that. He also teaches courses at the University of Geneva on the management of multilingualism and diversity, on language policy evaluation. He's the editor-in-chief of the journal Language Problems and Language Planning. He has been the deputy director of the European Center for Minority Issues in Germany, and I believe is now on the advisory board of the same center. And he's provided countless advice to public bodies on issues of language policy, planning, selection, and design. Professor Grin has steered many large research projects during the course of his career, and it's his most recent research project and the approaches and results of that project that he's here to speak to us about today. That project, Mobility and Inclusion in Multilingual Europe, is a truly ambitious project spanning 25 different teams across 16 countries over the last 4 years. And we're really looking forward to a very stimulating, rich, and very exciting keynote session today. I'm sure you will all have lots of questions that you want to ask him. So during the speech, please do write them down and make a note of them, because there will be an opportunity for you to ask him questions at the end. You can see in the audience there are microphones around, so get ready to line up behind the microphones or we will send a microphone to you. If you don't want to do that, you can also send me a question using our hashtag, and I will pick it up from Twitter. So, before I start, this is Professor Grin's third time in Thailand. He tells me some of the research he's going to share with us today was actually written here in Thailand, so I think it's really apt that he's here today with us telling us all about it. So please put your hands together and welcome our keynote speaker, Professor François Grin. Thank you.
Good morning. Bonjour. Let me begin, ministers, excellencies, colleagues and friends, ladies and gentlemen, by thanking the organizers of this conference for having invited me to join you for these 3 days. I think it's an extremely interesting, stimulating opportunity for me in particular to meet old friends, but also to meet new people and to talk about something that we all share, namely this passion for languages and linguistic diversity. And what I will try to do in this presentation is to tell you a little more about how we tried to nurture this passion and act upon it in the course of a large-scale research project that Mrs. Barrett has just mentioned. So the main ideas and aims of this talk should appear on your screen. I'm assuming the presentation is coming up. Oh, it's only behind me. I was hoping to see it on the sides, but if it's there, let me go back just once. Yes, it is right. So I'll try to remember what happens right behind me then. What are the main ideas for today? Essentially, it's a few very basic points, but we'll try to work on them and, you know, go somewhere with them. First of all, we all know that linguistic diversity has always been there, but it is taking on all kinds of new forms, largely because of globalization, because of technological progress. Now, what this means is that we are confronting added complexity. We always had challenges connected with linguistic diversity, but the old challenges are now combining with the challenges of the new, of these new developments. And I think this applies all over the world. The experience that I will try to contribute today comes from Europe, but I've worked in other parts of the world, and what I find is that very often you see fundamental problems coming up that are pretty much the same in various parts of the world. So I think we need to come up with new ways to think about linguistic diversity and how to manage it. And what I will try and do in this talk is to present an approach that is designed to help in this endeavor. So what I propose to do for today is to follow the handout that all of you have received. It's a handout with 18 points, 18 paragraphs. And in each of the slides that I will be presenting this morning, I will elaborate on one of these paragraphs. So if you look in the little upper right-hand corner of each slide, you'll find a number which connects with the number in, of a paragraph in the handout. So you can follow this in from two angles. And as has been said by Mrs. Barrett just a moment ago, today is really an opportunity for exchange, for discussion, so do feel free to ask questions. I certainly don't mind questions. I don't mind provocative questions either, because I think we are dealing with a very difficult, very complex issue in which, of course, some issues, some questions are difficult, and we shouldn't be afraid of addressing them. So the six main points for today, and that corresponds, as you can see with a little number in the upper right-hand corner, with the first point, the first paragraph in the handout. Essentially, what I will do is address the following points. I will tell you a little more about that project called MIME, Mobility and Inclusion in Multilingual Europe. Then I will emphasize the importance of interdisciplinarity. I will suggest a way of making disciplines cooperate when we have to work on about language and linguistic diversity. Then I'll mention a few of our main results, not many of those, but I will focus a little more on a meta-level result, which is about the meaning of inclusion. What does inclusion mean? And then we'll close with a few broader implications for research in this area. So what is the context of the project? As I said, MIME stands for Mobility and Inclusion in Multilingual Europe, and it was submitted to the European Commission. The European Commission, as you know, is the executive body of the European Union. The European Union is a group of 28 countries currently, which has officially 24 official and working languages, but actually has many, many more. First of all, because there is about 50 to 60 regional and minority languages, and then there is far more diversity supplied, contributed by migration from third countries. So languages, of course, and how to manage linguistic diversity is an important issue in Europe. And the call for proposals that we answered was entitled The Multilingual Challenge for the European Citizen. And the important word here is, of course, the word challenge. So if we keep going with this context, the call was a bit unusual, because the European Commission spends billions every year on research in all areas of science, and then they issue calls and say, well, this is what we want to hear about, please bring in proposals, and it's a competitive process. And in this particular call, called the Multilingual Challenge for the European Citizen, there was a very broad range of questions. They wanted answers, or at least, weren't clear whether they wanted answers, advice, guidance, right? But they wanted something said about all kinds of things about language. And for example, and that's a non-exhaustive list, you can find it on the internet, it was like a massive list of things that they wanted something about. Constitutional safeguards for linguistic minorities, sociological dimensions of the linguistic integration of immigrants, the complementarity between standard, traditional, second, third language teaching, and other things such as non-formal education, the contribution of lifelong learning, etc. They wanted something about the role of automatic translation and how technological advances makes automatic translation more widely usable in a broader range of contexts. They also wanted foresight. I'm really quoting them there, right? Foresight into what multilingualism for Europe or in Europe could be or should be, etc., etc., etc. So all this should be part of one single project. And of course, that's pretty big, right? So this is why we had to build a large consortium with 25 teams in 16 different countries. What I think is striking in this particular call, which made it very unusual, is a couple of things. One, of course, is that they wanted a joint perspective on all those issues. Because typically, what do we get? In usual research project, you normally try to focus on something more specific. For example, you would have research on language and teaching, and that would be done by researchers coming from education and sociolinguistics. Or you'd have research on language rights. Typically, the lawyers and the political scientists move front stage for this. Or you'd have research on automatic translation, and then you get people from translation studies and computer science. Or language and migration, for which you get like sociologists and sociolinguists together, etc. But we had to bring all this and more together under one roof within one large project. And another way in which the project, well, the call itself was really unusual was because of its insistence on interdisciplinarity. The European Commission explicitly requested, when issuing its call, interdisciplinary approach. And as you know, and I think I emphasize this in the handout, everybody says that they want interdisciplinarity, but very few people really mean it. Right? Usually, it's one of those nice, feel-good terms. You know, you want interdisciplinary perspectives. And traditionally, well, those of you who are involved in, you know, getting funding for research, you know how difficult it is. And there is a recent paper in the very famous journal called Nature that has explored statistically the success rate of interdisciplinary projects versus more traditional intradisciplinary projects. And they found that interdisciplinary projects have a consistently lower funding rate for success at getting funding than the more traditional projects. And this despite all those repeated calls for interdisciplinarity left, right, and center. So in this case, what was really nice was that the European Commission actually meant it. They were sincere when they said they wanted an interdisciplinary project. So we took this seriously, and we brought together 11 different disciplines or specialties. So we all came at it from our various angles, but again, and this is what I started out with, what brought us together, all those 25 teams, was our shared, our sincere passion for linguistic diversity, in addition to the intellectual interest of the enterprise. Now, what does interdisciplinarity mean? I think it's important to spend just one slide on this, is that interdisciplinarity is one possible approach when you combine different inputs from different horizons. You can quite simply, can also begin by simply, adding or juxtaposing, if you wish, several perspectives from education, from law, political science, etc. But that could be simply multidisciplinarity. At the other end of the spectrum, you can try to erase, blend, or transcend disciplinary cultures, try to bring this into a way of looking at reality that does not even refer to disciplines, and that would be transdisciplinarity. You're beyond the disciplines. Or you can try, and that's the way we went, we can try interdisciplinarity, which fundamentally means that you have a focus on a shared research object. So this is what really is a driving force, is a research object itself, and the shared interest in it, as I said, and then everybody approaches it with his or her respective perspective and respective disciplinary tools. So everybody makes a specific contribution. So you don't dissolve your intellectual, scientific, methodological individuality, but you make it work with the others. So what does this require? We need more than a common topic. We need more than something like, oh, we're going to do interdisciplinary work on multilingualism or the multilingual challenge, for that matter. We need something that's a bit tighter than this, and what we need is a common template. Common template would be like a set of explicit questions that we can all address from our respective perspectives in an interrelated fashion, but then again, each from his own perspective, right? You build interdisciplinarity from your own discipline, if you wish. Now, in our case, this common template emerged from one crucial observation. And the crucial observation, and that's something that's not new to any of us here, is that linguistic diversity isn't easy. In fact, it is quite challenging, and there again is the term challenge that we had in the title of the call. It's challenging because it requires us to balance two things, two opposing or at least non-converging goals. And these non-converging goals are mobility and inclusion. We see these terms, mobility and inclusion, animating all kinds of projects, all kinds of initiatives, and large-scale programs as well. And this is something that when we first got together in a small team to prepare this for this, to address this call, you know, it came out in our early discussions in 2012, that these two things had to be interconnected, and they're interconnected in a very interesting way, and that they would be central in our proposal. And as Mrs. Barrett has said, part of the proposal was actually written here in Thailand on Koh Lanta Island. Anyway, the two goals are mobility and inclusion. And what do we mean by this? Mobility means simply that, and this has been mentioned by the Director General a moment ago. This mobility means that we travel, we migrate, we trade. For all this, yes, of course, we need to communicate and we need to cooperate across languages and cultures. This goes, by the way, not just for physical, but also for virtual mobility. I think virtual mobility is part and parcel of the concept of mobility. And of course, this raises the question of in what language or languages do we do this? And likewise, inclusion. Inclusion is probably more complex. This is really where it took us the longest time to really think, what do we mean by inclusion and how does it mesh with the rest? By inclusion, we mean that each community, big or small, is something into which we may be more or less well included. We're always included in something, and it's the nature of this something that's crucial. And each community into which we can be more or less well included will want generally to preserve its specific, its unique character, including its characteristic languages and culture. So you see language coming up quite importantly when we think about what mobility is and when we think about what inclusion means. Now, the problem is that